So therefore, let's come now to the actual heart of the lecture. And that is, we want to now compare how the West, since we are now in Western education institutions, and in front of me are collegiate students, men and women, how does the West study the future? I mean, right now, how do Western societies look into the future? How do they study the future? And let's then compare it with how the Islamic world studies the future and draw some lessons from that. Well, the West still uses those ancient means based upon divination and upon astrology, these fairy tales and so forth. They still have a great portion of their ideas concerning the future is based upon that. For instance, indeed, until today, political decisions are still made based upon astrologers and fortune tellers and so forth. Many of you might have heard that during the time Ronald Reagan was president, and he was president for about 8 years in the United States, how his wife, Nancy Reagan, would not allow President Reagan to get on an airplane, to go to a country, to visit a place, unless they contacted their astrologer. And to see that, to make sure that nothing would happen to President Reagan. Nobody would try to assassinate him, the airplane wouldn't come and crash, that it would be beneficial for the United States of America, beneficial for his career, his political career, to do this or not to do this. So this is something in the 20th century, something now. I'm sure now if you look now, this is an election year in the United States, where you to look now at the various candidates, you might find a candidate or two who is still using astrology and so forth to determine how he should act in the primaries and the elections and so forth. These are ideas which are still today. About a few months ago, the Washington Post, the newspaper we have in the city of Washington, D.C., presented an article how the Pentagon, or the Department of Defense of the United States of America, has invested tens of millions of dollars into psychics in order to see if they can be used in warfare. So these type of ideas are still available, and they still are used in political and military planning. Strategic planning are based upon a lot of these type of things which we, of course, as Muslims recognize that it's all falsehood, like divination and astrology and so forth. And from this, what the West uses is the oracles of Nostradamus. Nostradamus has a central position in the ideas of many of these Westerners. And Nostradamus was a French soothsayer that appeared a couple of centuries ago, maybe three centuries ago or four. And he wrote a book which he took some, basically the ideas of his book were basically taken from either from what is mentioned in their scriptures, like in the book of Daniel, like what is mentioned in the Revelation of St. John, and perhaps he also took some stuff which is taken from the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, because many of the medieval Western writers and post-Renaissance writers took a lot of their ideas from Muslim writings, even though they wouldn't want to mention that. For instance, Dante's Divine Comedy, even though he attacks the Prophet ﷺ in there and describes that the Prophet ﷺ is in the hellfire and so forth, he stole most of these ideas from a book which was popular in the Middle Ages, the Muslims called Kitab al-Mi'raj, the book of the Prophet ﷺ's ascension to heaven, which is a fabricated book attributed to Ibn Abbas. But he did wholesale plagiarism from this book, which was prevalent especially among Sufi circles in Spain and so forth, and made its way into Central Europe and into Italy. But rather, instead of changing, he just changed the characters to fit Catholic theology. And I will have a discussion concerning Dante and why he said this about the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam on my lecture on Thursday regarding Western perceptions on Islam. The point is that Nostradamus still has an effect. In 1985, in the United States, a film was made regarding Nostradamus, and which he tries to interpret his event. The Nostradamus' oracle says that he interpreted the coming of the French Revolution and the appearance of Napoleon, the appearance of the United States of America as a world power, the fall of the Ottoman Khilafah or state, even the death of John Kennedy. And in the end, Nostradamus talks about the rise of an Oriental king who will take over the world, which they interpret now as the coming Muslims, which will take over civilization. And so therefore, in the movie, you see that a nuclear war occurs between the Muslims. You see people wearing Arab headgear like myself, and they take over city after city, and then finally they launch their weapons, and Western civilization comes to an end. The point is that these ideas are still current in Western thought, and for this reason why when Nostradamus in the late 1980s was very popular in America, and I don't know here if it was popular, but they base it upon. Also, they base it upon their scriptures in their knowledge of the future. Especially for the Christians and the Christian fundamentalists in the United States, base a lot of that upon the revelation of St. John, which is the last book, as I mentioned, of the New Testament. And they interpret all their ideas, basically, their theology, on that book and other books in the Bible. And for instance, they believe that prior to the return of Jesus, the Son of Mary, there will be a battle between the Muslims and the Christians, which they call Armageddon, and that they will launch nuclear weapons upon the Muslims and destroy them, and the Christians will be raised above the clouds and will, in what they call the rapture, and the people on the earth, the Muslims, who they call the idolaters or the Canaanites, will all come to death. And they say that the lake of fire burning with brimstone mentioned by Saint in the Revelation of John is the nuclear weapons which they will toss upon the Muslims, launch upon the Muslims. And so therefore in the last Gulf War, the Gulf War that occurred in 1990-1991 between the Americans and the West against Iraq, they thought this was the beginning, many thought in the West that this was the beginning of the Battle of Armageddon. Because in the New Testament and the Old Testament, there's many references to the Whore of Babylon. So he said, oh, you see, this is Iraq, which is inherited from Babylon. This is the Whore of Babylon, so therefore here it's going to come, and so forth. Judgment Day, Jesus is going to come any moment now, and so forth. So these are some of their ideas. And likewise, they'll interpret the beast mentioned in John's Revelation, Revelation of John, and likewise the false prophet, to represent certain Muslim leaders. If there's a political difference, with Khomeini or Gaddafi or Saddam Hussein or whoever, they'll say, you see, this refers to this, and you see in their books. And even though none of these interpretations have proven true over the last 20 years or so, because the Christians are, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes them in the Quran, like cattle or more astray, it makes no difference, you know. They say to them that Judgment Day will happen in 1986, and then 1986 comes, nothing happens, they'll believe something else. And so therefore, it's very easy for them to pass upon them these ideas. So this is the second source, therefore, of studies of the future in the West. The old source we mentioned of using of soothsaying and fortune telling, the use of the scriptures. The third source, of course, is what is known as the philosophy of history. Okay, and the philosophy of history was taken by and large from the writings of Ibn Khaldun. Ibn Khaldun is considered the first historical philosopher, the first one to try to see, try to put some certain laws or studies as to how nations rise and fall. And Europeans thereafter took that. For instance, you had a few centuries ago a person by the name of Hegel, who was a writer, who took some of these ideas from Ibn Khaldun and said that it would come to the end that Prussia, which is a part of East Germany now, I guess you would say, or maybe part of Poland, would be, everything would end with Prussia, and they would become the state which will dominate the world. Karl Marx took these ideas of Hegel and said, no, that the communist state would result in the end of the world, and that will be the final state to which all humanity will live in. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has proven them both liars, in the sense that Prussia no longer exists even as a political entity, and we know that communism has fallen as a state in Russia. In our own time, we've all witnessed the events, I'm sure, that occurred a few years ago. And recently, after the fall of communism, you find a person in the United States who, a person of Japanese origin, an American writer by the name of Francis Fukuyama, who wrote a book called The End of History, or The Last Man, or something like that, I didn't forget the title now, in where he said that the final development of human society will end with the Western liberal state, which is now seen in the United States of America and Western Europe to some degree. Also from this, you find, similar to this, they're not historical philosophers, but they are researchers. Who tried to study history and so forth, like an Englishman by the name of Arnold Toynbee. Arnold Toynbee is a very well-known historian. Perhaps some of you might have read some of his writings in your classes. He studied the rise and fall of the Roman Empire. And based upon this, he tried to understand why nations rise and fall. Again, of course, he was influenced by many of Ibn Khaldun's ideas, even though they tried to hide that. And he also interpreted that the West would eventually collapse, like the Roman Empire, a collapse in his history. Why? Because he said that the same causes for the collapse of the Roman Empire in terms of the decay of morality, the decay of the society's basic components like the families and so forth, led to the decay of the Roman Empire and will lead to the decay of the West. And he also felt that the Muslims were going to be the power of the future because of the Muslims still having being away from weakness in morality and still having strict moral standards. What is interesting, though, and this is something to understand, is that he was not just a researcher, he was not just a historian. I mean, most of us know that Arnold Toynbee was a historian. But more importantly, he was also the advisor for what was at that time the Ministry of the colonies, of British colonies. In the earlier part of the century, the United Kingdom, or Great Britain, had a lot of colonies around the world. And so therefore they used him as an advisor to use his knowledge in order for them to base their political decisions in the Islamic world. And when England lost its preeminence in the world, and this went to the United States, all these files were then transferred to the United States after World War II, as has been mentioned by Copeland in his book, The Game of the Nations. The point is that this third source is based upon study, whether it's a philosophical study of history or based upon research, and they make political and economic decisions based upon that. The fourth source used in the West for studying Muslims and studying the world in general is what we would refer to as, sometimes can be referred to as science fiction, or some sort of interpretation of that. A good example is George Orwell, who was referred to by many writers in the 20th century as the prophet of the 20th century. He wrote a book, which many of you know, called 1984, in which he tried to determine and tried to think, how would society be when ruled by totalitarian regimes? And also when they would have more technology, which was just starting to appear some 60 years ago or 70 years ago when he wrote that book. Likewise, you find writings by earlier writers like H.G. Wells, who tried to think, what would the future be like? And they based it upon some scientific fact, some study, but a lot of it was imaginative. And so therefore, some things which they said proved to be true, like human beings reaching the moon. When he wrote these ideas at the end of the last century, or the beginning part of this century, many people thought that was crazy. But he felt that since people were able to have done so much, then therefore it's just a matter of time before they're able to do such more. So this is a type of source used by the West, and it's based upon what we would call science fiction, and it has some fact in knowledge and science. Okay, the final source, the fifth source, which is used by the West in studying the Islamic world and studying the Muslims and the world in general, is what we call strategic planning studies. Specific strategic planning studies, where they get together, they bring all the knowledge of people about a subject and try to study a certain situation. What will happen? I remember a couple of years ago, I was at the company I was working for sent me on a training session, to learn some sort of new software. And there was some other people from the Department of Education. And as is normal when people sit together at lunch, people usually introduce themselves and what they're doing. And he told us that in his section of the Department of Education in the United States of America, they had just finished a study called America 2025, where, even though this is an internal study concerning their country, where they sat together and they decided to see what would America be like in the year 2025, after 30 years or 31 years. And they said that since with the introduction of new technologies, like the computer, American society is driving into two types of camps: those who are extremely poor and they are what we call, a computer illiterate, and those who are computer literate, and then therefore will have the economic and the knowledge power. And so therefore they took a test city of the city of Los Angeles, and they thought the city of Los Angeles in the year 2025 would be two cities. The inner city, where people are ignorant of the new technology, would be in such poverty that the people would be eating rats on the street, while you would have another part of society which would be such powerful and rich, because they're able to come with the new change of the world that's being introduced with the new communications, the new technology, and they will live in almost like separated, isolated zones. All right. What's the consequence of that? That the consequence, since this would be the minority of the population, that eventually this would lead to the overwhelming poor rising up in the cities. And this would have, of course, many implications for the political stability and even the concept of the United States of America. If you were to have massive riots and uprisings in 30 or 40 years, and you have these large segments of poor population. So then, therefore, what do they have to do? They have to make sure that the gap, which is occurring at an unbelievable rate, as traditional means of employment through making of factories and making products and so forth, is leaving America and going to cheap third world countries. And America is becoming basically a country which is living off information. That is the source of its income. They have to close that gap, because if they don't close that gap, it's going to have an implication upon the stability of that country. That's something which is internal to the United States. But let us think about how they study concerning the Islamic world. We all